Welcome to another spectacular episode of This Fool My Life, a podcast where we interview people from all walks of life and discuss how they maintain their fitness while achieving a work-life balance. I'm your co-host Ketan. Naam to suna hi hoga.
Hey, that's my line.
Today's subject is mental health. We here at foolme.co take our mental health very seriously and we urge you guys to do the same. This episode contains heavy material, so take your time to listen carefully. We have added timestamps so that you can jump to whatever section you want to listen to. Let's get started. Let me introduce you guys to Ms. Radha Gokhale. Radha is a psychologist who is pursuing her master's in counseling psychology. She is also an ice skater who has competed at an international level. Hi Radha, welcome to the show. How have you been?
Hi, I'm doing good, thanks.
So Radha, have you completed your master's yet?
Well, I would have, but because of this COVID-19 pandemic, I still have not completed my final exam, because of which I would get my degree. Yeah, I'm still there.
All right, all the best on your degree. Let's get down to things. I know the answer to this, but Radha, could you tell our audience the difference between a psychologist and a psychiatrist?
So the basic and the most important difference is in between the degrees. In India, at least, for a psychology degree, you have to enter the arts field, and whereas in psychiatry field, you have to enter the science field. In many of the international or foreign countries, psychology is considered in science itself, but in India, psychology comes under arts and psychiatry under science. So that's the most basic difference. When you become a psychiatrist, you can officially prescribe medicines to your patients or your clients, whereas a psychologist cannot. So a psychologist can help her or his client through therapies and many activities, but all which do not include any medications at all. So if the psychologist feels that the problem or the disorder that the client is having is much severe, then the psychologist can prescribe him to a psychiatrist, and then depending on what it is, the psychiatrist will give the appropriate medications. So the psychologist and the psychiatrist work together for that particular patient.
That's fascinating. How did you get interested in psychology? What inspired you to pursue counseling psychology?
So, psychology has been always fascinating for me, and when I entered 11th standard, in my college we had psychology as an optional subject, and I was genuinely very interested in it. So, without thinking much, I instantly chose psychology subject. And 11th, 12th, bachelor's and master's, I've been continuing psychology and I did not look back. So it was really interesting, and now I chose that as my special subject in graduation and master's as well.
Amazing. You are an ice skater. You have competed on an international level. Ice skating is still an uncommon sport in India. What challenges did you face during your journey?
So yes, ice skating is a very less known sport in India, and I've been ice skating for many years now. It is still fun, because when people come to know that I'm playing such an unusual sport, they are very amazed by it and they really look up to me. But yes, like you said, there are a lot of challenges that you face. In general, even the government, if you say, even they don't recognize the sport, they don't help with the sport in terms of finance or many things in general. Like, for example, even if you take education as an example, there is something as sports quota in India, where students who want to take admission for higher levels of education, the sports quota will help them in getting admission in a good college. So now there are many sports, but then when I was trying to get admission through this sports quota, I came to realize that there is apparently a list of sports that if your sport is not in that list, then you will not be able to use that sports quota.
Me and my parents were very disheartened by that. So much years of practicing winning medals, and we can't even get something as basic as an education through the sports quota, which other students, which other players who play a very common sport, which is added in that list, will get it easily, and I will not get that easily. So that's one thing. Even financially, if you look, it is an expensive sport. It does become a little difficult if the sports player comes from a middle class or a lower middle class background. So there have been a lot of difficulties, and still it is really amazing how all of us and my teammates or many people, my friends that I know, through all these difficulties, they still come up to a very high level with very less support or whatever it is, and they still achieve on a much higher level, and that is really, really amazing.
Well, that sounds amazing. It's an uphill battle, but once you conquer the hill, you're victorious, right? Well, I'm curious about a few things. What is the difference between ice skating, figure skating, and speed skating?
So, ice skating involves figure skating and speed skating. I am into speed skating. So speed skating also has two criteria, that is short track speed skating and long track speed skating. So in short track, basically, as the name stands for, the track or the track on which we skate is shorter. So the speed is more, and the long is basically the track is long, and there the speed does not matter as much. The distance matters. I am a short track speed skater. Another thing, figure skating and ice dance is basically, it involves a lot of choreography in it. So basically the spins and jumps that are there that you see in maybe movies or something, that is figure skating or ice dance.
That sounds pretty risky. You had a serious injury while ice skating, I hear. Post-injury, how did you change your lifestyle, specifically in terms of, say, fitness and nutrition? How would you say you eased into your recovery, you know, both mentally and physically?
So yes, there are a lot of injuries in this sport. Ice skating is one of the fastest sports in the world. There are a lot of injuries, so we have to take a lot of precaution. And I have been through a pretty major sports injury, if you may. It was a major change in my life when this injury happened, and it took a lot of time, honestly, a lot of time to heal. I had to go to physiotherapists and doctors and a lot of things. And so when you go through an injury, your physical, the workout or the physical exercises, activities that you do, it of course reduces. You have to give time for the injury to recover. It does become very frustrating, and like it tests your patience, to be honest. You know, you have to give time to recover. I had to start from the basic level, the exercises, the physical activity. I had to start from basic level. I had to do some very basic level exercise, and it was kind of a good thing to start from a easy pace again and not to be in that rigorous physical activity, to start from a very basic, easy pace. So that's the physical aspect of it. Even food. So now that the physical exercises has reduced, there is a chance of consuming a lot of food and it not getting used in exercise. So you have to look at the food intake so as to not, your weight to not to be increased a lot. So that is there. And coming to the mental or psychological part, as I said that it gets frustrating, you know, what we can do is get indulgent to some other activities that will make sure that your time gets spent and you don't think much about, or rather overthink about what is going on, because you are already on the right track of recovery. So there's no point in wasting your time and just overthinking because you have a lot of time in your hands. So the best part is to indulge in some activity which will not include a lot of physical exertion, but you can still enjoy yourself. So like, for example, I like painting a lot, so I indulged in that, and now my time is getting passed very productively, and also I'm focusing on my psychology degree also, as I said. So that's how you can a person can deal with the injury.
So, given a chance, would you like to compete professionally again? Why or why not?
It is an interesting question. I'm not very sure, but I think if I get the chance, then I would. But there will be a lot of things to be considered. Like now that I'm almost going to be a professional and as a early adult, there are a lot of responsibilities. So it will be kind of a dicey situation. I'll have to start from the basic level. But I think somewhere at the back of my mind, I would get back on a competitive level with my ice skating and really winning medals and standing on that podium and going to the podium while getting the medal is a really amazing feeling, and the fast-paced sport, and that feels obviously very amazing. But whatever the situation may be, if I continue or not, I still have plans, like, you know, plan A, plan B to go with. So I know that I've chosen a few right plans to go with. So if I start with ice skating again or psychology as a profession, whatever it may be, I think I will go on the right track nonetheless.
Once a champion, always a champion. So what is closer to your heart, ice skating or practicing psychology?
Oh my God, that's a very... okay. I think both, because one of the reasons why I thought that psychology would be a very good option or a choice for profession would be that I would get to combine sports and psychology together, which is a very recognized and vast field right now. It is getting a lot of recognition. So it's really hard to say, like, if I eventually become a sports psychologist, then it would be hard for me to choose sports or psychologist, because I will be a sports psychologist if I become a sports psychologist. Yeah, so both is very close to me. I don't think I have, like, I can choose really between my two favorites, if you may.
So it's like a perfect union between sports and psychology.
Yes, it is perfect, like you said.
All right, so therapy and psychological treatments are still taboo. What do you think the reason for this is?
The most common thing that people still think about is if you are going to a psychologist or a psychiatrist, people think that you are mad, you are crazy. This is the most obvious thing, and it is very degrading, to be honest. But like, they think that you are mental, you know, they use these words on a very general basis, like you are crazy, you are mental, and these things. And
the word mental has been stigmatized a
yes,
lot.
Very much. And it is very sad to hear all these things, because therapy or these psychology sessions can be as simple as some client has just come to you to just talk about things, to just open up, because he does not have anyone to just talk about these things with. For example, even if you're not a psychologist, you can be a good friend by just saying that I'm there for you. You know, these common things, I'm there for you. If you have anything to talk about, I am there for you. I will listen to you. And especially, I will not have any judgments for you. So that basically what a psychologist does. And as a third party, the psychologist does not know anything about you pre-hand. So, that does not create any biases. And so usually as friends, what we do is if someone is going through something, some problem, what the friend says ki, "Arre chhodna yaar, kuch nahi hota." Chal yaar, and especially if he's a man, you know, he'll say ki, "Arre chal na, tu kya ladki hai kya, ro kyun raha hai," and these things. So basically, or even if it's a girl, you know, "Stop crying, why are you crying?" ये सबके साथ होता है, दिस हैपन्स विद एवरी वन एंड यू आर नो स्पेशल और यू आर नॉट एनी डिफरेंट, दिस हैपन्स टू एवरी वन. सो या सो डोंट यू नो डोंट क्राई अबाउट इट, डोंट क्रिब अबाउट इट. And that is the person gets even more disheartened and he feels that he's just like nobody's there to understand him, to listen to him. And that is where a psychologist or someone who knows about psychology comes into. I will literally say to my client, if he wants to hear it, that I am here for you with all my heart and with all my attention. I will listen to you, I will not hold any judgments or biases or anything when you are talking with me.
Sometimes acceptance is all we want.
Yes, exactly. Knowing the fact that someone is there for you to support you, that acceptance and that support is really needed. And when once the And once you develop the trust as a psychologist to your client and in the client-psychologist relation, then the client will feel very relieved at that first stage itself, and then it becomes easier for the psychologist to help the client. So this is what everyone should understand, and we are trained in this. So we are trained in developing the trust. Like, you know, without being a friend, still developing that level of trust and understanding and helping in the same level is what we are trained for. And so people really need to understand that we are trained for this, and it does not make you mental or crazy, or even if you have some disorder, some psychological or psychiatric disorder, it still can get recovered. No matter how severe it is, there are chances of it getting recovered, and we basically tell the person that you can you can manage this disorder and live your life normally like you were doing before or like your friends are. So basically this this scariness that the person himself feels, that what is happening to me, oh my god, what will I do now, this fear is what we help the client to deal with. And the person can live, if it is a very severe disorder, like I said, we do help the clients with that. And you know, we basically help the client in managing all these things, whether it is on an emotional, mental, psychological level. We do help the clients with that so that the client get back to his normal life. So this is all that the client or any person in general needs to understand, and you know, remove that stigma of you know, these words like crazy or mad or mental and all these things should be removed, and it should be accepted more by more and more people.
It is okay to ask for help.
Yes, it is absolutely okay to ask for help. That is what normalizes you as a human being. You are a human being. So you are not some kind of a god. It is okay. That is what humanizes you, if I can say that. Ask for help. Ask for whatever you need, because there are people that will be there for you when you need something or when you need help.
True. We talked about sports psychology. So how do you think Indian athletes will, you know, benefit from therapy?
It is an amazing question, first of all. It does make a lot of difference and a lot of improvement if psychology is added in competitive sports. I can combine sports and psychology together. So now, from a young age itself, like I said that I've been skating for many years, from a young age itself, I could see a little boost or motivation from someone was needed. For myself also, and my teammates or my opponents or just every player that I have seen. And that boost was like, coaches could do motivate and boost us, but there's still something was missing. And I could see that in my performance as well. When I got older, and the self-awareness increased in me, I could see that something was there that could give an extra boost. So the coaches and parents, they were giving that, but somewhere it was missing. So one of the main reasons why I easily decided for psychology is that I came to know that psychologists can do that perfect job of giving you that extra boost or motivation that is needed apart from the coach and parents, because coaches and parents are related to you and they can have a personal opinion as such, whereas a psychologist is a completely third party person. Something that is missing or a motivation or a boost can be given, and the psychologist will listen to whatever you are going through without any bias or without any prejudice as such. That can be sometimes it's like you want someone to just listen to you without any bias and just, you know, give that kind of comfort or support to you and then help you out. So on a very basic level itself, like for example, in India especially, usually psychologists are provided to sports persons who are on a much higher level, like world championships, world cups or Olympics. But what I think is, I think it can be, psychology can be provided on a lesser or on a basic level as well. Because like I said earlier, that sports person or when they get into their adolescence or teenage or post-teenage, the chances of them quitting the sports becomes more. So if a psychologist is taken into picture on in that age itself, then there is a high chance of these sports persons not quitting the sport, continuing with it and achieve higher and higher levels of success in that particular sport. So that is, I think that is one of the main problems that I have seen or I have observed, that from an early age itself, if you are given that boost, then really the chances of quitting will be, because when you're in an early stage, quitting is more easier or is it is more thought about. Like when you are, if you are into world championships or world cups, the sense of quitting is there because of n number of reasons, but you know,
it's not a decision you take lightly.
Exactly. And as a younger or a pre-adult or something, quitting can be a very easy option, so that because there are a lot of options for you to move on with. But then, like I said earlier, then later life, the person will regret, why did I quit sport? So I think this can be avoided if you get some psychology backup from a very young age itself. And even parents also need that psychology backup. It's not just the students or just the sports players, because there are a lot of things that the parents are thinking about, many negative reasons that maybe sports is not a good thing to continue with, or even they might have some, even they might need motivation. Very honestly, even parents will need some motivation.
Some sort of positive reinforcement is required, even for parents, right?
Yes, it is. And so students, parents and coaches, these are the three most important things, obviously. So, and so the with the help of psychology, these three factors, if are taken care of, the success will be much higher and will be much concrete. Psychology, yes, it is very important to add the factor or the concept of psychology in sports from in all levels, from the basic level onwards.
Beautifully put. As a psychologist, you deal with a lot of clients, you know, with multiple emotional challenges. How do you balance your emotional state? Do you do it on your own or do you have a therapist of your own?
Yes. There are a lot of clients who have a lot of problems or a lot of difficulties. Some of them can be very severe, very serious for you to even listen to that, because even we are human beings, you know, even psychologists, psychiatrists, we are human beings ourselves. We do have emotions. So it can be a little tough to hear to these, listen to these problems and still maintain your calm. So you do need some support from some people. Some psychologists do have their own mentors that they can go talk to just say it out what they are going through, to just vent out their emotions themselves. Because as psychology has a lot of confidentiality policies, you are not very much supposed to talk with other people of your clients' problems and how it is, you know, creating some emotional disturbance in you. So that gets a lot of challenging. For you to deal with it alone, it becomes very challenging. But yes, many of us do have our own mentors to just vent it out and even to ask for help. There's nothing wrong for a successful, you know, highly recognized psychologist to have a mentor for to guide him with any clients. So that is there. Because like I said, we are human beings, we have our own emotions and we need to vent it out in order to regain that emotional balance. So that does become, and especially now that I am as a you know, you can call a newbie in this field, it becomes challenging. Like if I have some problems of my own and if the client is having some similar problems, it can be very difficult to guide that person through. It can be both ways. It can be in a good way that if there are these things that have helped me to get out of this problem, so I can help the client in these similar ways that I used for myself. But sometimes it can be negative or it can be challenging because all those memories can tend to come back to you and it can be overwhelming. But that's what we are trained to, not get overwhelmed or not lose our emotional balance, and as a third person help the client. We have to develop what our teachers call a switch on or switch off button. So basically what it is like, and it is a very interesting thing that my teachers told me about. So it's something like, for example, if I'm a married person and if a client is married herself and she is going through a divorce, and if I have marital problems in my own life, so we are talking about the similar problems that both of us have. So either the first thing, if you cannot deal with that problem that the client has that is similar to your own situation, then you honestly tell the client that I cannot help you with your problem. I will refer you to some other psychologist. Because the main reason, and you should not be shy in that, your pride should not come in between. Because you are dealing with a person's brain and a person's life. It is that person's entire life. So whatever you say can have a negative, horrible impact on the client's life.
So you can positively or negatively bias your client.
Yes,
just because of
very
your
much.
Existing conditions.
Yes. So if you think that is going to happen, then you should immediately tell the client that I'm sorry, I cannot handle your case. I can refer you to some other psychologist. Or if you think that you can handle it, then you have to switch on the button of being a third party and not thinking about the marital problems. As an example, not think about these problems that you are going through and help the client from a third party basis. And then once the client is gone, has left your center, clinic or your office, then if you want to vent about it, then you can switch off that button and talk with your mentor.
So basically you just need to avoid your emotional triggers while dealing with the
yes.
client.
Yes, that is exactly. So that is like a switch on, switch off basis, concept that we are trained, and it honestly, it becomes very difficult for me personally to deal with it. But then as my clients have increased, it has increased a lot, and I can kind of do that switch on, switch off thing, and it is very amazing. That feeling is very amazing, that no matter what you're going through, you can still help the person who's going through something similar, and that is really amazing.
Beautiful, beautiful. So what is the most valuable lesson you learned being in psychology?
Okay, so like I said, this switch on, switch off thing is very good, even on a personal level also. I think all the things that I've said till now are the most like self-awareness, observation skills, and empathy. You know, learning the difference between empathy and sympathy. So sympathy is like crying with that person yourself. Oh, you're going through that problem, so even I am going through it. Let's cry together. You know, that is sympathy. And empathy is something like, oh, you're crying? Okay, I understand. I am there for you. If you don't want any help as such, if you just want someone to listen, then I will still do that. You know, that understanding that difference when a person needs help and when a person only needs support or just a ear to listen to all these things I have learned. Like, these are so overlapping things, the difference between all these things and using all these things, and when it becomes helpful, these are really amazing. And this is what I have learned, and even the n number of theories that are there in psychology that deal with almost everything that is going on with the world or that a person can go through. There are so many theories. Honestly, it is very hard to study all these theories, but then once you get to know how it can be effective in practical life or how it can be effective on the person, that is like a great deal, and that is very amazing to learn.
It's pretty enlightening. Mental health is important to me. I've sought therapy in the past and I've had positive results. I'd like our audience to experience the same. So how would you encourage our audience to seek help from mental health practitioners?
Firstly, it is really amazing that you approached a psychologist, a practitioner, and sought help. And I'm very happy for you that it worked. The results were good.
Thank you.
Yes, and I just hope, just like you, everyone thinks about that with an open mind. If you are thinking that you have something to talk about, like we talked about this, there is no shame about hiding this or, you know, not talking about it or not expressing it. So the first step can be, if you don't know anyone who is a professional in this area, you can just do some, you know, you can just search somewhere, like you can do a research where any psychologist, counselor, psychiatrist, therapist, any of these are available near your area where it is easily accessible, and you can just approach to them. The most easiest part is just talk about it. Talk about whatever you are feeling. Sometimes it can happen that you are thinking about it so much that you think that the problem is too much, or you're ashamed of it. Or sometimes it does happen that you think that there's not a problem at all. So why is it bothering me? All other people are going through something similar, but why is it bothering me? No, it's not a problem. I should just, you know, not think about it. That is not a really good idea. If you're thinking that it is bothering you, no matter what it is, you should talk about it. You should approach to a psychologist or any professional. Don't compare yourself to others, or don't try to think that no, everything is okay. No, if you think that you need to talk about it, then go and talk about it.
So basically, don't downplay your emotions or whatever your feelings are.
Yes, exactly. Very well put. That is exactly how it is. The easiest way that you can go about it is talking about it. Go to a psychologist or any professional, and you will come to know that there are very easily available solutions or help or ways that you can deal with this problem. So just go to a professional and talk. That is the first and necessary step that you have to take. Go and talk, open up.
Absolutely. How do you approach treating a client? So say when a client comes to you, so how do you deal with their problems?
Yes, so this answer will give a broader idea about your question earlier. How should clients approach the professionals? clients usually, or just people in general, usually have that mentality or that thinking, what will I say when I meet the psychologist, or what am I expected to say? The basic question is, what should I go to the psychologist or not? And then what am I supposed to say? Or what if the psychologist thinks of me in a certain way? You know, like judgments. Will the psychologist will have some judgments or some negativity about me? So should I tell everything to the psychologist, or should I just hide a certain things, or what should I tell, or should I even go or not? So I think this is the basic confusion. But really, what we do when we have a new client coming for the first time, the action plan kind of that we follow in general is, when the client comes in, obviously we just try to make him, you know, comfortable. We don't rush the client to tell what he wants to tell. Like, when he comes, we'll not, yes, hi, tell me what's your problem, tell me, you know, like, we don't rush it. We just see that he has sat down, if he wants some water. Like, the most basic things also matter for the client to be comfortable around you and in your office. So, you know, you can just offer some water, just ask about the most basic questions, like, how did you come here? And, you know, you can just start with these very basic things. And usually you do not ask that, tell me your problem, what is your problem? You know, we don't poke in that way, because once the client, it usually does happen that once the client gets comfortable, he will start talking on his own. And if he does not, then we can ask in a good manner, so tell me, how can I help you, you know, without making that client uncomfortable. And usually there are some clients who will start talking immediately. Some are there who we need to wait for them. So even there are some clients who will not talk at all for the entire session. And it is all right. We do not have to rush. We have to make that client comfortable, no matter if it takes an entire session. And once the client understands that this psychologist is waiting for me to get comfortable and is trying to build that trust, then the client will eventually start talking about. And then we can start talking a little about trust and confidentiality, that how we, you know, we focus on this trust part and how confidentiality will be maintained, because these clients do have a lot of, they have these questions that, if I go to a psychologist, will she tell others that I'm going to a psychologist? And that's what scares them.
What you say in the office stays in the office.
Exactly. It stays in the four walls. So nothing is going to get out. Your name also, your identity, nothing is going to get out of these four walls. So this is the most basic thing. And then, you know, as we go on, the client starts talking. And in the first stages, we don't really question the client or poke the client or stop the client, cut the client's words. We just listen to everything that they have to say. It sometimes does happen that the client will say something that is contradictory to what they have said earlier. But we have to listen to everything. It doesn't matter how much or what they are talking about, we just have to listen. And then once the trust has been developed, then we can ask about the specific things. Like, you know, like, for example, earlier you said that you talked about this earlier, but so can we come back to that and talk about the thing that you said? And are you comfortable in talking about that particular thing? And if that client is comfortable, then he'll talk about it. If he says that, no, I'm still not comfortable with it, then you have to not ask that thing again. Maybe after 2-3 sessions, then you can ask the client that, now are you comfortable to talk about this particular issue? And then he'll say, like, yes, now I'm comfortable, and then we'll go. So this is how careful we have to go about with each and every question. And after, usually after 2-3 sessions is when the counseling process actually starts. So for the first 2-3 sessions, it's just about building the confidentiality, building the trust, you know, these things are there.
So
exactly. So it can be a very crucial thing. It can take a lot of patience for you as a psychologist, and then you can actually start with the counseling session. So this is this is how it is. So if any person has any doubts that the psychologist will judge me, if I approach him or her, she will judge me, she'll think of me in some weird or some negative way, or should I really talking about, or should my secrets will get exposed, that is not going to happen at all. It is a very free and safe and comfortable space. You don't need to have those doubts in your mind if you, many people do not know what to talk about. So I would say that just talk whatever you want to talk about. You do not have to think about what I should talk about and what I should not. Talk about whatever you feel like. That's the best way to go with.
All right. So let's get to the daily things. What is your daily routine now? How are you managing your physical as well as mental well-being these days?
Oh, this is such a frequently asked questions now, because all of us are going through this huge change in our daily life. My daily routine has also changed completely, and I am doing pretty much the similar things that I was doing earlier before this, this pandemic situation, but still a lot of things have changed. My my sleeping and eating schedules in general have also changed, and how I have to manage that, and the things that I've always been doing is working out, exercising and painting a lot. I like a lot of painting. And and also studying. I still study, even though I don't know when my exam is going to happen. I still go through a different psychology related, books or my syllabus in general and everything. So, but now, what a good thing, or like a a good thing actually has happened is that now I'm getting time to do it easily, like in a eased and relaxed manner.
You're not rushed.
Absolutely not at all. And it is very good for people like me who, for some people it is an advantage to go with these daily routine in a very easy manner. So pretty much the routine is being similar, but I do get a lot of time to just relax and chill, if you can say. Like I said, that workout is there. So in the morning I wake up, do my workout, and I don't have to think about finishing my workout quickly so that I have to go out and go to college or to just go out somewhere, because it is scheduled. Or then I get a lot of time to paint. So painting is something that I do in my free time, and which was not happening very often. And I was kind of missing that, but now I have more time in my hands and I am getting the chance. I've started a new painting, by the way, and
that's wonderful. When can we get to see it?
Soon, very soon, because it is going in a very good way. It is working out the way I had imagined it, and yes, I'll show it to you very soon. And so that is there. And painting usually takes a lot of time, so I can do that without thinking about going anywhere else. And I'm getting to eat a lot of homemade different kinds of food. In what way? My mother is she has started a new hobby of cooking, of baking. So I'm getting a lot to eat cakes and all these things. So that is a very good thing for everyone, because even all my friends who like cooking, or their parents like cooking, they are having a wonderful time, like a family time kind of, to cook together and to eat together. So that is a thing that was kind of missing, because at my house every family member had their different routines. So everyone would come at different time, have their meals at different time. So now that is not really happening. We are having our food at a similar time, and we are you know, talking about like the basic things, like we are talking about what we want to have and what we would like to have, and we are helping my mom to help you know, to cook all these things. So it is a very wholesome kind of a feeling. Of course, there's a lot of irritation and frustration as well, but then when I get very irritated or even lazy, I just think that, you know, no, Radha, don't overthink it, or don't, you know, just feel down because you don't have anything to do or you don't want anything to do and such things. You can, there are a lot of things that you can still do sitting at your house, so you can do that. And of course, when you're a lot bored, there is, you know, these general things like listening to music or watching movies, web series and all these things. So there is
or social media, or even listening to the yes. This Fume Life podcast.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Definitely, yes. So it is a very wholesome experience that I am getting to have.
Absolutely. So moving on to the next segment. This is a favorite segment here at This Fume Life. We have a rapid fire round for you, Radha, so that our audience can get to know you better.
That's interesting.
All right. Let's begin. Favorite ice skater?
Apollo Ono from US and Stephen Paul from India.
Favorite exercise form?
Favorite exercise, squats.
Me too. Favorite food?
Favorite food, biryani and ice cream.
Wonderful choices. Favorite series or movie?
The latest that I'm watching right now is The Big Bang Theory.
That's nice. Favorite art medium, oil paints or watercolors?
Okay. Oil paints.
Graffiti or cartoons?
Graffiti, big time. My walls are covered with graffiti.
This concludes our rapid fire round. So now we're moving towards the end of our podcast. So what are upcoming plans for the near future?
So upcoming plans, the basic plan that is in my mind, becoming a psychologist working in the field of sports and support sports as much as I possibly can, spreading the awareness of sports in how it can be an activity also non-professionally, and how you can succeed competitively also, and how you can reach higher levels of success in sports, how it can be a career option. It's revolves completely around sports, basically. Yeah.
Wonderful. At the end of the day, what contributes to your mental satisfaction? What is the thing that makes you happy at the end of the day?
What makes me happy would be, as a psychologist, if I can better the life of my clients. So basically, how the clients can say that because of my support, how they were able to better their own lives on their own ways by my support. So when I do have clients right now, current, which I'm talking with, which I'm having an appointment on the phone, and whenever there is a small, even a small level of achievement that they have in their daily life, it is really good for me. Like, I am succeeding, I am developing. Yeah, that's a wholesome feeling that I have.
Well, it must be nice to help out people, right?
Yes, very much.
All right, guys, so this concludes our podcast episode.
Thank you for inviting me here.
It's our pleasure. I'll be linking all of Radha's social media handles in the description. Do check them out. Also check our previous videos. For more content like this, like, share and subscribe to our channel. Stay fit, stay happy. Oh.